Hi, this is Santi Trimarchi from the University of Milan, and on behalf of the co-authors, I'm going to give a speech on the management of retrograde intramural hematoma with acute arch tear or type B aortic dissection. Co-authors of this paper are Fuka Nauta, MD, PhD, Department of Cardiothoracic Surgery, Amsterdam, the Netherlands, Hector de Beaufort, MD, PhD, Department of Cardiothoracic Surgery, San Antonius Hospital, Nieuwegein, the Netherlands, Firas Moussa, MD, University of South Carolina School of Medicine, Columbia, South Carolina, US, Carlo De Vincentis, MD, Department of Cardiac Surgery, Policlinico San Donato Milanese, Milan, Italy, Atsushi Mura, MD, Department of Cardiovascular Surgery, National Cerebral and Cardiovascular Center, Suita, Japan, Hitoshi Matsuda, MD, Department of Cardiovascular Surgery, National Cerebral and Cardiovascular Center, Suita, Japan, and myself. An acute aortic intramural hematoma is defined by the presence of hemorrhage within the aortic wall without evidence of intimal tear. This aortic injury may evolve into the aortic dissection rupture and therefore is considered a lethal condition and, of course, an acute aortic syndrome. The incidence of intramural hematoma in patients affected by aortic dissection varies between 10 and 30%. However, in the largest series, which is based on the International Registry of Acute Aortic Dissection, the IRAD, the overall incidence of intramural hematoma among all dissections was 6%. Within these patients, the majority presented with an hematoma involving only the descending aorta, compared to those who had an arch or ascending involvement, which represent about 42% of the entire cohort. And this is different than classic acute aortic dissection, which primarily regards type A and not type B. Intramural hematoma that origins in the descending aorta may extend into the arch or even into the ascending aorta, and all these are referred as retrograde type A intramural hematoma or retro TAIMH. Intramural hematoma might originate from small intimal tears followed by retrograde extension dissection with thrombosis at this level. Such lesion is likely to be induced by increased wall stress on already weakened tissue. On these problems, several potential clinical risk factors have been identified for MH, such as older age, larger aortic diameter, and increased aortic wall thickness. The clinical presentation of IMH patient is quite comparable to those suffering from aortic dissection. The vast majority presents with acute chest pain, may show also hemodynamic instability. It has been also reported as patients affected by intramural hematoma type A more frequently are older than 65 years old, more frequently are female, are affected by Marfan syndrome and may also have a retrograde dissection when compared to those who present with the classic type A acute aortic dissection. Intramural hematoma patients may show fewer distal malperfusion when compared with the classic acute dissection patients, in particular visceral, renal and limb ischemia, both when patients present with type A intramural hematoma and type B. While cardiac tamponade is more frequent in acute type A dissection than intramural hematoma because of dissection can present more frequently frank rupture into the pericardium than intramural hematoma. Intramural hematoma as well as aortic dissection are usually detected by using of CT scan or more rarely by MRI. In this patient, intramural hematoma and acute dissection can be present at a different aortic level in the same patients. Such imaging may show as thrombosis, false lumen in acute dissection shows curvilinear intramural clots, often missing a well-defined outer wall. This is because of mediastinal hematoma or pleural effusion, which are both more common in these patients. Regarding aortic diameter, no clear difference have been detected comparing intramural hematoma and aortic dissection with an average of 5 cm in the ascending part and 4 cm in the descending aorta. The prognosis of acute intramural hematoma can be compared to that of the acute dissection. In hospital, mortality may vary between 12 and 26% for type A, both intramural hematoma and aortic dissection, while for those patients who present descending involvement, such in-hospital mortality may range from 5% to 11% in both types of patients affected by this acute aortic syndrome. In particular, patients with intramural hematoma and concomitant PAU are associated also with increased risk of aortic expansion and even rupture. This is an historical report from Circulation in 2003 in which a different type of evolution of intramural hematoma was described. Patient may present a resorbed complete hematoma in up to one-third of the case, 10% can evolve with the classic dissection of the true and false lumen, 22% of this patient may present a fusiform aneurysm evolution, 8% may develop a saccular aneurysm, and one-fourth of this patient may also develop a pseudoaneurysm in the location of the previous intramural hematoma. In terms of management trends and recommendation for treating type A intramural hematoma, the optimal management is still debated. We all know that in Western sites there is an indication for emergent surgical aortic repair, in particular for those patients who are in a stable condition. For those who are in a clinical stable condition at presentation, these are typically first managed medically in anticipation of a subacute surgical repair. Nonetheless, several Asian sites have recently reported the promising results with the initial medical treatment in type A intramural hematoma. It is also important to say that on this, it is not yet clear if this is caused by different definition of the disease or by a truly different etiology of the aortic lesion. Nevertheless, another important point that needs to be highlighted in this setting is that there is a subset of patients with acute retrograde type A dissection plus minus intramural hematoma who might be managed non-operatively with acceptable short and long-term results, and this might become of importance as the age of this patient is increasing over the last decades. In general, intramural hematoma who is located in the arch or more distally in the descending are less likely to be associated with adverse outcome when compared to the type A intramural hematoma. So in these cases, best medical therapy might be enough, might be suffice, as we say over here. For type B intramural hematoma patients, when refractory chest pain is present or there is an increasing of the sizing or at the level of the hematoma or even pleural effusion or aortic rupture, of course, there is a clear indication for an endovascular or surgical treatment. Thoracic endovascular repair that nowadays indicated in all symptomatic or complicated type B intramural hematoma patients just because it increases the risk of aortic rupture. Currently, TEVAR may be indicated in patients with the progression of the intramural hematoma towards dissection or rupture. Some predictors of intramural complication has been reported, like maximum aortic diameter over 50 millimeters or enlarging aortic diameter or recurrent pleural effusion, among others. This is a 58-year-old female patient that we observed a time ago with descending intramural hematoma. In day 11, she developed a PAU ulcer-like imaging within the hematoma of the descending aorta, and also pain was recurrent and refractory to therapy. CT scan showed the presence of aortic dilatation, so the patient needed to be treated in the short term, and for this was submitted to a TEVAR with the resolution of the imaging as well as the clinical condition. When patients with descending intramural hematoma need to be treated, there is also an important risk of TEVAR, in particular when intramural hematoma is located up to the zone 2 of the level of the left hemi arch. And this is because the endograft may tear through the intimal surface, determining a retrograde lesion which might involve the proximal part of the arch and even the ascending aorta. So based on this, the endograft should be anchored in a non-involved wall above and below the intimal defect. I would say more importantly, proximally than distally. Another patient, female, 63-year-old, who presented with intramural hematoma involving the left hemi arch, plaques in zone 2, in addition to IMH, as you can see in the CT scan. This patient had also recurrent and refractory pain over the initial week. And for such condition, was managed with TEVAR starting in zone 2, previous left carotid subclavian bypass and plug at the origin of the LSA. As you can see here in the postoperative CT scan, plug is located just at the origin of LSA. This is deployed for preventing type 2 endoleak in this patient. So we perform the same strategy for intramural hematoma that we perform for classic type B dissection. Nevertheless, we have to say that open repair is the most appropriate technique for treating this patient. And the reason is because in those patients presenting with the retrograde type A intramural hematoma, the risk of neurological or cardiac complication due to TEVAR are much higher. Surgical aortic repair remains the gold standard in these patients when they present complicated type A intramural hematoma. In this patient presenting with such condition, the use of strips of Teflon felt might be positive for reinforcing the anastomosis, and sometimes often also some bioglue is added in this setting. The distal extent of the aortic repair is determined by the diameter of the aortic arch, especially in case of type B dissection with the retrograde type A intramural hematoma. Enlargement of the arch about 5 cm is not uncommon, so concomitant aortic arch repair in this specific case may be required. In this condition, the use of deep hypothermic circulatory arrest, selective cerebral perfusion, and other techniques of brain monitoring are adopted, likely the regular frozen elephant trunk that is adopted for aneurysm. The proximal extent of the aortic repair in this patient is usually confined at the supracoronary lines. This is because there is less involvement of root and valve. Therefore, the surgical procedure time for intramural Type A compared to classic Type A dissection is significantly shorter. These two group of patients, the outcome did not differ when we consider stroke and in-hospital mortality. For patients with the retro type A intramural hematoma, other techniques may be adopted. There are two main options for hybrid repair. One is represented by the ascending or right partial arch replacement with the branching, at least for brachiocephalic and the left common carotid artery, in order to create a long and safe landing zone for subsequent TEVAR. TEVAR that can be performed in the same procedure or sometimes is staged in another procedure. The other option is represented by the ascending and total arch replacement using a classical frozen elephant trunk. Also, in this case, an additional TEVAR may be necessary and deployed in the same stage or in a second stage. For these patients managed using hybrid repair, a pooled analysis of results show a 30-day mortality ranging from 5 to 12%. Thoracic endovascular repair for these patients affected by retrograde type A intramural hematoma due to lesion in the descending aorta, such therapy has been already advised. Based also on the extension of the retrograde dissection, which might involve the arch or extend up to the ascending aorta. This is one of the patients that we presented in the previous paper. You can see the thrombosed false lumen in the ascending aorta with the TEER. In the descending aorta and presence of the patent false lumen. Then you can see on the right-hand side the 2-month CT follow-up, which showed nice results with thrombosed false lumen. Similarly, other small case series have recently reported showing acceptable results using endovascular treatment for repairing retro type A intramural hematoma. This slide, you can see the figure, in particular the B figure, which show the site of entry tears and then the extension of the disease which involve of the ascending aorta, and then the nice results after the endovascular repair. This data comes from one of our co-authors, Dr. Matsuta Group. Is an unpublished work in which they showed the use of TEVAR in 8 patients, patients presenting with the retrograde ascending involvement of acute dissection, which started in the descending aorta. These 8 patients were considered to be at a prohibitive surgical risk. Nevertheless, after TEVAR procedure, they achieved a good outcome. A 30-day mortality was zero, as well as the very nice CT scan, which showed a complete size shrinkage, a good remodeling of the descending aorta, and both of the ascending. All these patients affected by intramural hematoma, including also the retrograde intramural hematoma as well as type B, need follow-up. 5-year follow-up is advised. It has been reported that aortic enlargement for Bs during follow-up is significantly less common when compared to those patients with acute B dissection, means presenting with patent true and false lumen. Conclusion, we can say that the retro type A intramural hematoma is an acute aortic syndrome and should be managed as such. The recommended treatment strategy is open surgery for treating ascending or arch involvement in fit patients whenever this is possible. However, There's a subset of patients with acute retrograde type A dissection intramural hematoma who can be managed non-operatively with acceptable short and long-term results. In those patients in whom retro type A intramural hematoma is associated with an acute B dissection presenting with the proximal tear located in the descending aorta, today TEVA represents an option treatment. For those with only descending localization, treatment is TEVA or medical, and this is based on a complication-specific approach. All these considerations imply that a selective approach might be reasonable. I wish to thank all the co-authors of this manuscript, and thank you all for your attention.